I know that there will be many people who are relieved. And perhaps quite a few who will also be disappointed.
A great man brought down. A great man brought down.
And I want you to know how sad I am to be giving up the best job in the world. But them's the breaks.
Going.
In the last few days, I've tried to persuade my colleagues.
Going.
And I regret not to have been successful in those arguments.
But not quite gone.
Because I felt it was my job, my duty, my obligation to you to continue to do what we promised in 2019.
Defiant even in defeat, the British PM will stay on as leader until his replacement is found. Boris Johnson lashing his many deserters on his way out the door.
But as we've seen at Westminster, the herd instinct is powerful. When the herd moves, it moves.
I've just heard the speech and I think it was absolutely abysmal. There's no sorry, no nothing. It's just like, come on, pitiful.
The mistakes that led to the mutiny noticeably absent. Partygate and, more recently, the promotion of an accused sex pest and deception of his own ministers.
He's been struggling for months, telling lies, misleading everybody.
The lie upon lie upon lie, I think, into the British public for fools. He's some sort of megalomaniac, I think.
His ego's gone mad, he's just Putin, but over there, isn't he?
I don't think he should say no, I don't think he's great.
It's a sentiment shared by many who want Boris gone sooner rather than later. For someone else to take the reins for now.
I do think it is quite incredible, though, to suggest that he will remain as Prime Minister for another 3 to 4 months.
He needs to go completely. None of this nonsense about clinging on for a few months. He's inflicted lies, fraud and chaos.
Chaos is right. And it's set to continue, with no clear successor in sight and Boris not quite ready to say bye-bye just yet.
Thank you all very much. Thank you.
Wow. All right, journalist Barbara Serra joins us now from London. Barbara, from afar, this whole thing seems like absolute chaos, is it?
Yeah, no, it was chaos from here as well, from here in London. I have to say the situation is a little less chaotic now because at least now we know that he has resigned. We don't know when exactly he's leaving, but a couple of days ago, there were people worrying that maybe he was going to pull a Trump and just sort of not leave. And the past few days have been absolutely insane. You had resignation after resignation. Some of the news channels actually had a little bug on screen with the number of, you know, government ministers resigning, going up the whole time. We've had 3 education secretaries in 3 days. So at least that side of things has calmed down. But the truth is, we just don't know, A, when he's leaving, and crucially, who will replace him and when.
I mean, back home in Oz, Barbara, when you're gone, you are gone. So why is he hanging around?
Well, because there hasn't been an election. So when there's elections, the same thing happens here. But this was all done by the Conservative Party. So even though the opposition is threatening to do things through the Commons before it goes into recess for the summer, if he's still there, the truth is that it's up to the Conservative Party to find a new leader. So if it was an election, he would be gone. But in fairness, he'd say, well, there's no replacement. Question is, why didn't the Deputy Prime Minister step in? I thought that's what Deputy Prime Ministers were meant to do, but it hasn't happened. And so now they're looking for a replacement and it could take months.
Barbara, Boris is apparently planning a massive wedding party in a month's time at the Prime Minister's country estate. Is that why he won't leave?
Well, I mean, I haven't been invited, so I don't know.
But I'm sorry.
Downing Street is not... I know. But Downing Street is not denying that the party... You know, they're not denying the reports that this wedding party should be held at Chequers, which is one of the country residences of the Prime Minister. It's sort of fitting with the man, isn't it? I mean, it is the kind of thing that Boris Johnson would do. I don't think it's the only reason. I think there's a lot of other issues, but certainly that's the one that's captured the imagination.
Doesn't he know that if you're not there, it's not really a party? Boris was always the lovable rogue for so many voters. He didn't seem to be able to do any wrong. He had that storming election victory just a couple of years ago. How did it turn so fast?
You know, it didn't really turn that fast. I think the Pincher case that you mentioned, the one you called the sex fest in your report, that was the final straw. But the reality is that it's been going on for a while. And personally, if you ask me, it was the Partygate scandal that I think really changed the people's perceptions. Because, you know, maybe journalists like us follow the ins and outs of things that happen at Westminster, and most people don't. But so many of us in the UK, in Australia, everywhere, made so many sacrifices during lockdown, that the fact that they were having parties in Downing Street, I think, really damaged his standing in the eyes of the public. So I don't think it happened suddenly. I think that was just the final straw.
Barbara, you've covered a lot of wacky leaders in your time. Where does Bojo sit on the Trump to Berlusconi scale?
I know, right, because I'm Italian, so my threshold for political instability is really high, and they've been doing well. So listen, I'll tell you what, I know that's why I came to this country, you know, for the political sanity, but listen, this is the way that I see it. I think Berlusconi owned his party. I mean, he literally created his political party. You could argue that Trump has captured the Republican Party. I mean, we've seen how so many Republicans defended his claim that he hadn't lost the election, or certainly even the events of the 6th of January. I think we need to remember that if Boris Johnson is packing his bags eventually from Downing Street, it's because of the Conservative Party. It's because the minister stood down. It's because it became obvious that the party didn't back him up. So I think when you look at these leaders, the question always is, you know, how much have they been able to capture the party, and how long will their legacy last? Have they changed the politics in the country and within the party forever? And I think whereas you could maybe argue that for Trump and Berlusconi and others, I don't think you can say the same for Boris Johnson. And that's why it would be incredibly interesting to see who succeeds him. It might be someone really, really boring, and considering how many problems the UK has right now, including the economy and a crushing cost of living crisis, maybe boring wouldn't be so bad.
Bojo was not boring, was he? Barbara, thanks for your time.
Thank you.